I do apologize for being so nasty, like, from the pill thing, because I know how that feels, and I apologize.
Thank you.
For not, for trying to be tough and badass and talking about Ela and everything. Like, I always feel bad. Like, I feel bad about it when it's not in a joking mode, when it wasn't, when you triggered me, I felt bad. When I was like, good luck trying to get your wife pregnant. Like, it was just a mean thing. I don't know what it was, and I'm sorry, and I feel bad. Like, that's not me.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to my channel. I hope you're having a fantastic day. I am a person who considers herself a grown, independent, strong-ass woman. But I also suffer from mental illness. I recently got diagnosed in the last 3 years with BPD, borderline personality disorder. I was diagnosed in 2017 and I've been working to overcome my symptoms and my episodes since then. I did DBT solo, not group. I needed only so many sessions and compared to some people who do it for years, but it saved my life. It literally saved my whole life. I was someone who was struggling, who got frustrated, who had episodic issues, who had outbursts, who had panic attacks in public. And even though I'd maintained work, I had maintained relationships, friendships, I had somehow maintained a healthy life, I still was unhealthy in many ways, mostly when I was alone. And when I was alone and having these horrible episodes, I can't even explain to you how bad it was. But I did have a habit of pulling a Trisha. In the beginning of my YouTube career, I was so honest and forthcoming because I thought that's what everyone was doing on YouTube. And I think it is a symptom sort of a borderline, because Trisha has it as well, where Trisha just shares and shares and shares. She like overshares to the point where even I myself have had to dial it back over the years with oversharing. I mean, some people would say this is oversharing because we shouldn't be talking about our mental illnesses online. But as a person who knows there's a heavy portion of BPD people in my audience, I want to always reassure you that you can get better, you are in control of your life, and DBT works. It might not work for all of you, but it definitely works for a lot of people. Borderlines are already a minority, right? They're 3% of the population, as we know, but obviously it's also hard to get diagnosed because you might not know it's actually an issue. The way I knew my borderline was an issue was that I would switch. I would become like a completely different person, that my most petty, my most raw idea of a person, no kindness, no benefit of the doubt, would come out. And Trisha has displayed this over time.
Anything else?
That's it.
Moses, do you want to have anything to say? End it. Moses is warning me.
Well, just because I'm quitting this show, don't fire Moses because of me.
Why would I fire Moses because of you?
I don't know. People be doing that.
Estimate your influence.
Oh, I know how you guys are with him. Oh my God, Trisha did this. Oh my God, Trisha did that. Are we should be scared of Trisha? It's like,
I've never said anything like that to him.
I seen your group chats. I literally see his phone.
Well, you bragging about looking through his phone isn't exactly the best look.
I'm not bragging about it. I'm stating something because, once again, I'm open.
Well, I've never said anything like that to
him. I'm open about it. Like, yeah, I'm not a perfect person. I'm a crazy person sometimes. Like, whatever. I'm open about it.
I'm sorry for calling you crazy.
That's, I know this offensive. Has been off the rails.
Yeah, I apologize.
I don't apologize for anything I said about you.
That's okay.
And I'll say it again.
It's fine, but I know that this went off the rails.
I know you have issues because of your family, and I get it, and I understand that, and I'm sympathetic to it. So my apologies, but that's it.
But I can tell that when I said that, it upset you, and I was sincerely, I thought we were goofing around because...
Well, you look unhappy in life, so I really hope you feel better. I know it came from a place that you're miserable.
I know... Yeah,
I know you are.
Because I thought we were goofing on each other, kind of thing. But I genuinely, I'm sorry for saying that. I'm genuine.
Okay.
And
I'm like literally gonna leave that like once it's over.
No, I know. So I'm trying. I just want to. Okay. I'm trying to resolve this because
the more we talk about it, the worse it's gonna be. Like, good luck. Honestly, good luck. Thanks for having me on 5 episodes. Love it. It was so much fun, and I'm over it. Good luck. And I'm sorry about your family situation. I'm sorry about your situation.
No,
I know you're miserable.
No, it's
you
not
are.
True.
I can tell. I can tell. And it's sadness. And I see you when I was around your family that you have sadness in you, and it's sad.
Okay.
And that's why you're so mean to people on the internet. And I get it, but also don't take it out on people and call them crazy and shit.
No, I apologize.
Okay, cool. Great. That's a wrap.
I do think you're a good person, and I am sorry for calling you crazy.
Cool. I'll weaponize you later then. On my channel. Can't wait for the weaponizing. Everyone comes to me because I'm crazy and I weaponize against people. Like, it's all me. I never get provoked.
Yeah, no, I can see why I provoked you, because I can be like asshole-ish.
It's not asshole. It's like literally like pushing someone to do something when they're uncomfortable. That's like literally like, it's an attack. I mean, that's literally like awful. But anyways.
Right. Okay. All right, cool. Okay. And I will wish you well, because I've always wished you well. And I could tell you hate me so much right now, but I don't hate you.
Cool. I know.
I like you still. Mm. My feelings didn't change for you.
Cool. Love it.
There's no way to calm you down, I feel like.
I'm fine. I'm literally just
No, but like, there's
it.
No
I'm
way.
So over it.
You just hate me so much. I just wish there was a way.
I know. Yeah, whatever. There is, because I hate people just like that are you. You're the person I hate in this world.
Really?
That's so just offensive, but they do nothing wrong. And when people are provoked, oh, they're crazy, calling girls crazy and stuff like that. It's like, but taking no accountability, no responsibility. You think everything's just an attack against you. Everyone's against Ethan. Like, oh my gosh, I'm always right. It's like, ugh, you and Jax film deserve each other, so.
Jax? Well, I can't believe you're going after Jax. He's such a sweet guy.
Bye. Love you.
All right, Trisha. All right,
bye.
It's not, you don't have to choose between me and Moses. He can do both, even if we hate each other. He'll go with you.
Okay, bye.
Yeah.
In the beginning stages of my career, I used to cry on camera too, like a lot. Like, I'd have an episode, I'd get triggered, and then I'd film a video. Trisha's done this so much over the years. And one of the reasons why I stopped hating Trisha was because she ended up having a hangout with somebody I knew, and they were like, oh, she's nothing like that. She's a really good person. And then I started realizing over time that Trisha is one of the most honest, weird people I've ever seen in content. And it was completely full circle today when I watched the new Frenemies Best Podcast ever. The Frenemies with her and Ethan, because Ethan is her opposite. Ethan is the most genuine person on YouTube, almost period. And the reason I know this about Ethan is not because I actually know people who know him or anything, but because of the way he treats Trisha. You can tell his authentic desire to not be cruel, to be warm, to be understanding, is all displayed with his interaction with Trisha.
So this is our first fight, our big real fight. She snapped on me and she left. I'm gonna try to do a post-mortem on this. I don't know, maybe she's just having a bad day. But I do, you wanna comment, Moses? Moses came back. You wanna sit down? Go ahead, get her phone. Yeah. She's like, Moses, you pick who you're staying with. But I was like, go ahead. Oh, Moses is here.
Just give it time.
Okay, yeah, no, I figure.
I am warmed by this, motivated, inspired to always maintain that grounded Brittany brain that I know offers the most compassion to the world. Before I got diagnosed with borderline, I was considered a pretty warm person, though I have a tough love exterior, so if you're not ready for that, probably don't watch my channel. And I am a good community member. People like me. I choose the wrong partners, or I have in the past, because I'd often choose them for the wrong reasons. Like, oh, their potential seemed so good, versus dating people for who they actually are, which is wrong, and I shouldn't do that, and I've definitely stopped. But it is one of those things where watching Trisha allows me to watch myself in so many ways. Dr. Drew? Oh God, I don't follow these Dr. Phil, Dr. Drew, Dr. I think that's his name, Dr. Drew. Anyways, he's the doctor who they brought on. I know he's a celebrity doctor and he's, you know, number two-esque where they formulate these, but the advice he gives to them is actually really spot on, which is basically acknowledging that Trisha is getting triggered and Ethan is being insensitive, but at the same time, Dr. Drew sums it up really well. They have to feel comfortable insulting each other to make this line of work work. And that's how I feel. That's how I know Ethan is also genuine. Ethan knows, if you're a YouTuber in comedy especially, if you're a reaction channel, you gotta be a little funny. Like, you gotta be funny enough that people would wanna watch you watching other people. And so there has to be a way we can all make fun of each other without getting triggered. And Trisha and Ethan are our greatest examples of observation. They obviously have moments in interaction where Trisha just like, she can take the joke, and then all of a sudden she can't take the joke. And we watch a real person get really triggered on the internet. There are so many people on the internet who are like, I'm triggered. Oh my God, you're not fucking triggered. You're just a teenager who can't hold their own emotional state like solid, but you're 25 or 26 or 32. Some of us have actual mental illnesses that when we are triggered, we actually have severe consequences. So what I'm trying to reassure people of is if you're a human who gets medically triggered, there is hope for you. I am a year clean of any borderline symptoms, episodes, anxiety, or depression. And it all stemmed from getting the help I actually needed. I had to go through so many therapists in terms of, I had to email over 72 therapists, two replied. I fired the first one because she told me if I didn't get on meds, she wouldn't help me, which is so stupid. I never needed a pill. I've never taken a pill my whole life because I'm not the kind of person who needs it. If you need it, that's fine. But I take a more holistic approach to science, and I believe in medicine. I'm not saying I don't, but I also believe that pharmaceutical companies are pushing medicine on us that we don't necessarily need. I'm not a huge proponent of most medication unless it is helping you. If it is helping you, then it's just a tool to utilize, and you should definitely utilize it. So for me personally, finding a therapist was hard. Once I found the woman who basically saved my life, even though she's probably so unaware of it, I cannot tell you how good life got. Life was such a beautiful, wondrous thing. And I want that for Trisha. I want it for Ethan. I do not care most of the time about how people feel about the world, as long as they're being genuine, because obviously their life has informed them of a certain specific belief they have. What I get frustrated with is when people push that narrative onto everyone else and say, this is how the whole world should be. But some of us aren't like you. And that's why I think YouTube is a beautiful place, because if you need soft love and comfort, you can go find that. If you need tough love from a crazy auntie or from a tough love mom, I can give you that. And I needed that. The therapist who saved my life was a tough love cookie. Right away, she was like, look, I don't really care if you kill yourself because that's on you. And I was like, oh my God. She was like, but let's make a pros and cons list. And I appreciated that. I needed someone to talk to me like a real person, like, hey, I'm feeling crazy and this cannot be normal. If this is normal, I'm gonna kill myself. My episodes were not happening with just anyone. They only happen with people I trust who lied to me. So my borderline is completely triggered by being lied to. And usually when I say that, like, I'm triggered, I mean I'm literally about to say for it and remove myself from the situation. So when I was diagnosed with borderline, one of the things that was a consistent thing my sister heard was, oh my God, I'm so sorry, your sister is a borderline. You're such a lovely person for continuing to love her. You're such a big person for loving her. And my sister was just so shocked. And she goes, Brittany, why does everyone think you're crazy? And I was like, oh, because if you Google borderline, the internet is flooded with crazy people, borderlines who haven't gotten help, and people who have dated borderlines who haven't gotten help. Because let me tell you, I am not afraid to hold myself accountable for my past actions. I already did the work in regards to that. My therapist told me I had to go apologize to the people I hurt, genuinely. And I had to understand that regardless of them hurting me, I hurt them. So I went on an apology tour. I apologized to people. It took a long time because I wasn't ready to forgive certain people. And then I had to really work on it. And it worked. I don't hate existence anymore. I don't hate my life. And I don't have borderline episodes. I don't get triggered. Now, the reason my sister never saw me, never had me attack her as a borderline, because borderlines, like, we're very, like, look, like, we get, our whole body gets into it. Like, we've seen Trisha do it, we've seen me do it. And I'm not saying Trisha has borderline, but she's in DBT, so she either has borderline or has a personality disorder that's similar, and it makes sense. My borderline completely stems from my childhood trauma of coming out as gay. First woman in history of our Iraqi family to come out, and the first woman in my family. I'm the first woman in my family to leave the church. I'm the first woman in my family to do a lot. So rejection from a young age was very clear when I was younger. And it was only after I got help for DBT that I could help repair the damages that I did with my family. Because keep in mind, that need for borderlines to just cut people out of their life and run is so we don't get hurt. So my borderline manifested only when people lied to me. And since my sister's never lied to me, I never get triggered by her. So she's never been the target of an episode. My parents and my boyfriends and girlfriends that I've dated have always been the trigger for my borderline. Because when my partners have lied to me, or in some cases cheated on me, it's like, it's the most devastating thing I can't even explain to you how much it hurts. When my parents would say things to me like, being a homosexual will make people pedophiles, that was triggering to me because I'm gay, I'm queer, I'm bisexual, and I'm not a pedophile. So I was like, what? And it felt like a lie. When my parents would say things like, God is real, but wouldn't give me tangible evidence, it felt like a lie. But to them, it's not a lie. So I, through DBT, came to I came to a place where I was able to seriously process information as facts and feelings. So as an example, when my parents say to me now, you know, God is real, as long as I'm not in that environment for, you know, 3 weeks plus, I found out that my threshold is usually about 3 weeks. If I'm there visiting less than 3 weeks, it doesn't ever trigger me. So Dr. Drew, he says in the video to Trisha, we need a word to let people know you're about to have an episode. So I actually use BDSM terminology. I use red, which means stop. And so my family has all adopted that safe word for the most part. So if I am being triggered, I usually say like, ooh, safe word or red, I'm exiting this conversation. So here I am visiting my family and I'm almost a year clean of any symptoms. I'm almost a year of being close to getting triggered. And I wasn't gonna fuck it up for a situation that didn't warrant it. So I looked at my family, I looked at my mother and said, I'm going to excuse myself, I'm safe wording, I am redding out of this conversation. And I walked away from the situation, grabbed a cigarette, and had a good old fashioned smoke. And I felt better. I had avoided being triggered, I didn't have an episode, I used my DBT skills, and I was able to process why my mother was also upset because she was also getting triggered, which is not her fault. And so though we are responsible for our mental illnesses, I also know there is a balance between holding responsibility, taking blame, and then pointing blame. I think all of them contextually have an appropriate time to be expressed. But in that moment, I realized she was too far gone and I hadn't been triggered yet. So I had a chance to be the bigger person and I took that chance. It was better. It was for the best. Everything turned out okay. And we're in a much better place than where we were even before. My family and I have only been able to get better and better over time because I'm the person who spent thousands of dollars on therapy. So I have tools that have never been introduced to my family. My family's Middle Eastern, we're immigrants. Therapy is hoaxy to them, it's woo-woo. And they're not wrong for feeling hesitant about it because they've tried it and it sucked. And I've tried it and it sucked. It's really hard to find a good therapist. So I understand when we're on the internet and we're observing people like Trisha, it is so easy to write her off as a troll. But I'm telling you, Troll, yes, is a part of her brand, but also her uniqueness and her genuine, authentic personality, it's there. And as much as we don't like it because it's not the way we think people should be, it is who she is. Like, she is that person. And so why do certain parts of YouTube look so fake to us when they're these like white liberal types who are trying to stand up as allies? It's because they don't really care about mental illness. They care about publicizing your mental illness as a fun thing. Like, that's why I don't watch BreadTube anymore. It's why I don't watch the white liberal kind of voices of YouTube anymore who are on the SJW side. Because as much as they want to pretend they're pro mental illness, they're the people I know who've either not changed therapists because they're too scared, even though they know their therapist is fucking them up. Or two, they're the people who honestly have the hardest time actually getting the help they need. It's different when conservatives choose not to go to therapy because they think it's woo-woo. That comes from a belief system that they don't even believe in therapy. But when liberals and leftists say they believe in therapy and mental health, but they don't go do it because, oh, it's too expensive, as if, oh, I'm sorry, do you not have a credit card? Because you certainly are willing to put yourself in debt for Cheetos. Like, I did that. I put myself in credit card debt for therapy. And I'm sorry, like, it was worth it. My life, my sanity was worth it. And if it's not worth it to you, that's still on you. You can't blame society for your inability to take a sacrifice like paying interest or taking out a loan to go to therapy. I'm sorry that we live in a world where therapists aren't free, but at the same time, therapists need to feed their families too. So it's like one of those weird conundrums. I paid $145. That was with insurance. I got $20 off an hour for my therapy. And I didn't even go as long as some of the people I know who have been going, but I know I got better and the proof is in the pudding. I'm happier every day. And some of you even reached out to me and said that you also finally went and got help and it's changed your life. Who knew that people who study the brain might actually know something about it? And at the same time, those tiny contradictions we have to keep in mind in life, you still have to work hard to even find a therapist that works. I know people who have suffered from mental illness and gone to like 4 or 5 therapists and all of them have been like, oh, you're normal. But it's not normal. Some of the things we're experiencing aren't normal. Like, I knew, like, my ability to work 80 hours a week, pay my rent, like, I was literally paying for our apartment with my ex-boyfriend. I was paying for all of our shit. I made the money. I worked 2 jobs. I worked my ass off while he literally flunked his way out of school. And so when he would trigger me, he would become the target. And he tried to do this whole thing where he was like, you're a sick person and you're the reason I'm a bad boyfriend. But I've talked to enough of his ex-girlfriends he has a pattern of consistency. And of course, I'm not a therapist or psychologist, but I'm reading this book called Disarming the Narcissist. And it's become so clear to me that like borderlines and narcissists are attracted to each other for so many reasons. And I understand that if you have borderline and you're undiagnosed or unhelped, how crazy life feels. But please get help. Get help. Your life will change. And please know if you're a good person or not, because that's gonna save you when you're feeling like shit. I know I'm a good person. And I knew I was a good person when I was spiraling, so I knew something was wrong. I'm a good person. Why is this happening? Why am I having panic attacks in the middle of a food festival in Seattle and I'm on the floor crying? I've never done that before. And it was because I was dating someone at the time and he had triggered me so hard. And I realized like him triggering me isn't his responsibility. It's my responsibility to avoid getting triggered and to learn what to do when I am triggered. And at the same time, it's my responsibility to stay away from people that lie to me, that trigger me, or that bring that negatively impact my life. A lot of the time on the internet, we talk about like, oh, I can never be friends with Trisha because Trisha Paytas doesn't respect trans people. But Trisha Paytas, in some part of her brain, completely believes she is trans. I mean, if non-binary people get to be trans, I'm sorry, like how is Trisha not basically non-binary? Like if you follow the rules of your own gender identification, you get to choose your identification. Trisha gets to choose to be trans. She gets to choose because she feels like it's super, she feels like it's super authentic.
Basically the criticism was that you're using trans issues to basically get attention for yourself and to make mm-hmm. money.
Yeah.
So you lost on both sides, right? People who are critical of trans issues and the yes. trans allies both attacked you.
Yes. Yeah. Well, my trans friends were supportive of me, as was my therapist. You know, they were pretty supportive. So I would say it was more actually the allies. It's more like cis people being like, fuck this bitch, you know, or a lot of like gay guys too, but...
I did a video, and I don't know if it's still up, I think it is, where I wanted to be referred to only as T because I didn't feel like I identified as a girl. Now, this seems like crazy and weird and shocking because I was born a female.
Now, previously, just to give context, you've also made videos coming out as a... you made videos coming out as like a cheese puff or some shit? What was the video coming out as a chicken?
But it wasn't a sit down one. It wasn't like using personal thing. Yeah, I mean, that's what I do. I did online for a long time. It's just.
So people didn't take her thing seriously.
And I understand that. That I understood completely. I get why people didn't. It just hurt that it did.
Just give you some important context there. But you can't really come out as a chicken nugget.
I didn't come out as a chicken nugget. It was a spoken word poetry when I was fucked up on meth. And I was like, hey, today I woke up feeling like a fucking chicken nugget, y'all. Like, that's what it was. And I was, like, so fucked up if you watch the video. Completely different than this video where I'm, like, sitting down. I'm like, hey, I have something, like, I want to say. Like, this is, like, on my chest. It's been on me for a while. And there's been tons of videos of me talking about penis envy, about me wanting to be a boy, not wanting to be Trish, like, all this stuff. And there's been multiple videos that I talked about this and expressed this. And this one just, I guess, triggered people because everyone wanted to hate me last year, including H3, Nick Akato, PewDiePie. Everyone attacked me, all these people. So it just was the year of hating Trish last year.
So here's the deal with when people declare things on drugs, everybody. They're on drugs.
Thank you.
they're fucked up. Let's just leave it at that. Do not try to interpret what people are saying.
What about people who are drunk and say things like...
No. They're on drugs. That's a mistake. Go, oh, their true feelings coming out. No, that's the person on drugs. Mm-hmm. Now, really? There may be some de-repression. There may be some things coming out that they wouldn't otherwise speak. But the way they speak and the way they speak about it is somebody on drugs. So give them a chance, if they've revealed something, to come back around and talk about what's really going on. Mm. And your brain isn't integrated. Your whole self isn't there when you're loaded.
You know, stuff like that. But that's why I identify more as like a gay man, because I like guys, but I also identify as a guy, if that makes sense. The thing that kind of like stops it is I do love, which a lot of gay men do too, I do love like glam and voluptuousness. So in my head, I feel like I'm a transgender female to male, but also like a drag queen. Kind of how I've like.
That is exactly right.
Because so, like,
Ian.
That is exactly right. She's a gay, identify as gay male drag queen. That is exactly what that is.
And you don't think
right. I think your construct is exactly correct. Whether or not that's your firm, you know, forever identity, I don't know. But that's what you're describing, which is I don't really feel like a female, but I feel like a female cross-dresser.
Right.
I like all the female stuff, but I identify as sort of a gay man. Now, the question is, are you attracted to gay men?
So yeah,
because a gay man would be attracted to gay men.
Yeah, I dated.
Dating a straight man. Apparently.
Well, right now I am, but I dated a gay man for 2 years. That was very public, you know. So there
I dated a gay man.
How did you guys navigate that?
How does that work for him?
And that's, I think, a lot of people, like, I mean, he would say he...
I'm asked this as just strictly curiosities. And if it's not,
are you saying, like, sexually, like, intimately?
Yeah.
Like, well, like, it's a navigation, right? And so it's an interesting, we're all like, how'd you do that?
Yeah, well, we were definitely friends. And I was like, oh, you're definitely gay. And he's like, but I'm like, I like you. And I was like, well, I don't know. So then we just started, like, hooking up within months into our friendship, and then realizing that we're dating, that's what we're doing. And it was hard, and that's the ultimate demise. The internet was like, he's obviously gay, Trish. And the thing was, is like, my energy and just like day to day, I mean, I've always dated feminine guys. Like, I feel like I have just masculine energy by nature. I'm usually like, you know, I don't know, like, to say that a lot of people, I'm like, to me, he said he was bi. The other day I just talked to him and he's like, actually, I just like who I like, you know? So it was never, we did have like vaginal sex, but it was a lot of, it was a lot of more, pegging and penetration, that stuff.
Okay. Holy all right. Shit. Interesting.
Did you
that stuff you like doing?
I love it.
Yeah.
And even now with my like my OnlyFans, I'm always the one to wear the strap on, like with girl and girl stuff. Like, I'm always the one doing the. I just feel more powerful. I feel more turned on that way.
Now, if she gets therapy and realizes that trans feeling only came from an issue with her mental illness, that's fine. But doesn't that also encourage that if you think you're trans, you should probably go get therapy first to make sure you're trans? That's what I'm saying. We live with all these contradictions. You can't say Trisha is lying that she's trans, because obviously look at her, but yet ignore everything she said about her identity in terms of gender. And that's the thing that drives me crazy. But as a person with a mental illness, I also know how hard it is to finally get to therapy. It was a lot of work. And one of the things my ex actually did help me with, even though I think he's a clinical narcissist, but I can't be sure, is he took me to therapy. I didn't want to go alone, so he would take me. The issue is that he was hoping my mental illness was the reason I didn't want that relationship. But the truth is that because he took me to therapy and encouraged me to get it, my therapist made me realize, hey, you're dating a person who's super bad for you. You should probably break up with this person. But, you know, so anyways, I always think that's really funny. Like, the little irony of, like, I think he was hoping I would stay with him, but therapy made me realize, like, oh, he's got a bad one. Like, whatever it is, and I can't literally call him the N-word, but like, whatever it is bad. And I can't fuck with it, you know what I mean? Because I went to therapy. I literally was that girl who was on again, off again, on again, off again, on again. What the fuck are we doing? We're adults. And I realized, like, yeah, people, couples who get off, there's an issue there. It's not just a stereotype of a broken relationship. I mean, it's literally an indicator of one. So as much as it might work for some people in the end, I wish I had the wisdom now, but I didn't. And the reason I went through the hard things I did in my past was so I could have the wisdom now to share with you. Love is a powerful drug, and Trisha wants it more than I've ever seen a person want love. And honestly, as much as people want to hate on her, she is an inspiration to me. As somebody who is so obviously fucked up and has tried so hard to be better, but it looks so weird to see. She's so weird, and like, a part of me just like admires that. And she's not a bird. I mean, she literally has her own money. She makes her own. She's not asking for handouts. She's not asking for much. She just wants to be able to express herself and to make the content she wants. So for all the people who are always trying to cancel Trisha, maybe you should just cancel your fucking selves. Because unlike you, I like her, and she helps me remember where I was and where I think she can end up. I think she can be just like me, because she has a determination in her that I see, that I think might manifest into something great one day. I know it's hard to imagine that people with mental illnesses are like everyone else, but we're not. We're different, and we have to own that, and we have to deal with that. Our humanity is the same, but our struggle is different. And I always wanna be a beacon of tough love hope to remind you, you are responsible for what happens with your brain and what you do with your body. So remember, when you make those mistakes, to apologize. And that is something I really want for Trisha. I want it so bad for her, but I can't save her. She has to save herself. I want Trisha to eventually learn how to apologize for real. She doesn't know how to do that yet because her walls are up and she's feeling defensive and she doesn't want to get hurt. Because the first step to forgiving yourself and being a better person is truly understanding that you've hurt others. And once she figures out how to truly apologize to other people, it's gonna be beautiful. It's gonna be beautiful, and I'm here for it. I am here for it. I wanna thank people who have heard me out and who have been supportive through the last 10 years. My life has been so weird, but what a blessing. And I know that every hardship I faced, every awful moment, it brought me here. So fuck it, I'm good with it. All right, I gotta go. Thanks for watching, have a great day, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye.
The cocoon, it felt like you were literally in one of those cocoons. Was that the feeling you had? That's like you were in a, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, it literally just feels like it's like an autopilot where I'm just like, I don't even know what I'm saying. Like in the moment, I literally feel like I shouldn't be doing this. I sound like a bitch, this is not who I am. And I just like could not apologize. Yeah, it's
like you're not even there. You're just inside this chrysalis. And we're just talking to the outside of the cocoon and it's just repeating stuff over and over again. Yeah. So, you know, you're going to be there again.
Well, the good news is, though, that I'm here now. If you have something to say.
I do. I said it in the video. Did you pulled it up?
I didn't. Well, I'm here. I don't need to watch another video.
I feel horrible. I do apologize for being so nasty, like from the pill thing, because I know how that feels. And I apologize.
Thank you.
For trying to be tough and badass and talking about Ela and everything. Like, I always feel bad. Like I feel bad about it when it's not in a joking mode, when it wasn't, when you triggered me, I felt bad. When I was like, good luck trying to get your wife pregnant. Like it was just a mean thing. I don't know what it was. And I'm sorry. And I feel bad. Like that's not me.
Thank you.
It's not the last time.
I do know you don't mean it.
You'll do it again.
No, but I know you don't mean it.
But you'll know what it is. You'll know what it is anyway.
I feel like
think of that cocoon.
I feel like it would feel better for you to apologize and get it out of your, because I know you don't mean it.
No, I know. No, I felt bad. It's just like in that moment I felt attacked.
I do forgive you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.